stores. I love them. Okay.
She's here.
Okay.
Our opening hymn is Holy, 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 from KCC 4.
this morning in prayer. Father God, we thank you for this wonderful day to be in the house of the Lord with your people. Lord, to be here, to lift you up, to worship you. For that is the reason which we come this morning. Heavenly Father, we ask that your Holy Spirit have its way with our hearts this morning. Lord, that we may worship you in spirit and in truth. We may cling to your word, and in prayer, Lord, we may discuss with you the things that go on in our hearts, that we may learn what your word tells us, so that we may be in line with your truth. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the many blessings you have given us. We thank you for this great country that we live in. Lord, we pray for its leadership, our president and governor and mayor, and also those men and women who make decisions for us. We pray for our military, those who have served, those who are serving, because we have been blessed by the service. And we lift up to you, Lord, this morning, all of the prayer requests, so that we not only mention, but the ones that are silent in the hearts of all that are out here this morning. Lord, we pray for those who are joining us Facebook Live or on YouTube later on today. Lord, we just pray for their requests as well. Lord, you are the God that knows our hearts and hears our words. And Lord, we just pray that you will help us understand your will and be patient, Lord, in receiving our requests. Lord, we thank you for being our God who loves us, who has provided for us. We thank you for our pastor and his family. We pray for your blessing to be upon them, Lord. As a new year is in front of us, it will have many kinds of challenges in it. And Lord, may our hearts be prepared in truth and in love, Lord, to serve you, Lord, like we've never served you before. We thank you, Lord, for this church and its many facets of ministries. We pray for our children's ministry, our youth ministry, our adult ministries. Lord, we pray that you will draw us closer and be discipled into your word. And Lord, that we may be obedient in all things that we do. Lord, may the love of God fill our hearts. May it fill us that others may see Christ living in us. And Heavenly Father, we lift up to you this church, and Lord, we pray over it and all who are part of it. And most of all, this morning we come to say thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for our sins, paid our way, and took our pain. And Lord, there's many pain that much people feel in this world today. And Lord, we just pray for your wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. We pray, Lord, for your healing. We pray, Lord, for your answers. And Heavenly Father, we know that in your word, you will never go against it. And Lord, show us that in your word, how we can live for you. We know that in your word, it teaches us much about who Christ is. One day a disciple came to Christ and said, Lord, how should we pray? The Lord said to that disciple, to the others who were there, when you pray like this.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Y'all probably see me over there flipping my glasses and stuff. I'm trying to get the fog out of them. Thank y'all for coming. Ramiro and I have a song that I've been wanting to sing, and it's been on my heart for like the last 2 months. It's called Lord, Light the Fire Again.
Mm-hmm.
Our scripture this morning is from the book of Acts, the 19th chapter. While Apollos was at Corinth, Paul took the road through the interior and arrived at Ephesus. There he found some disciples and asked them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?" They answered, "No. We've not even heard there is a Holy Spirit." So Paul asked, "Then what baptism did you receive?" "John's baptism," they replied. Paul said, "John's baptism was a baptism of repentance. He told people to believe in the one coming after him, that is, in Jesus." On hearing this, they were baptized into the name of the Lord Jesus. When Paul placed his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came on them. They spoke in tongues and prophesied. And there were about 12 men in all. Paul entered the synagogue and spoke boldly for 3 months, arguing persuasively about the kingdom of God. But some of them became obstinate, and they refused to believe and publicly maligned the way. So Paul left them, took the disciples with him, and had discussions daily in the lecture halls of Chironesus. This went on for about 2 years, so that all the Jews and Greeks who lived in the province of Asia heard the word of the Lord. May God add a blessing to the reading and hearing of God's holy word. On this first Sunday of Epiphany, the topic is the baptism of the Lord. And we've already kind of covered that in the second week of Advent. And it's always been a challenge for me. How do you redo a month later the same basic scripture from a different gospel? And so I went looking in the lectionary at Acts. Wonder what that scripture is. And it was about baptism. And it seemed appropriate. Virtually all of us have been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit is baptism in every denomination. Some might still say Holy Ghost, but all of us virtually have been baptized somewhere along the way. Some as infants, some as adults, and a few of us somewhere in between. I think many of you know my story of my baptism. My family, we began to attend the Baptist Church. It was one of my dad's clients. And we were attending Baptist Church in Bradenton, Florida. And Dad really liked the preacher. That was the main criteria for any church we went to. He had to like the preacher. And so Dad mentioned the possibility of us joining the church. And he said, "Well, you and your wife can join, but your children can't join because they haven't been baptized." And as I tell the story, and I don't know how close this resembles reality, he told the pastor, "Oh, well, then we just won't join." And the pastor said, "Well, how old are your children?" "Well, they're 8 and 10. And he said, "Well, we only do adult believer baptism, but they can interview with deacons, and if they qualify, then they can be baptized, and their whole family can be baptized together. And so, we went, all of us went, I guess, and separately interviewed with the deacons. I can't really remember the interview very well. They asked me, did I believe in Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior? I was in third grade. I had learned about true and false tests. I was in church. I was positive the answer was true. And so I said yes. And they asked me some other questions along the way, and I answered yes to all of the questions that they asked. And they said, you qualify for baptism. And so I was baptized as a believer at 8 years old. And it was a neat experience. But nothing happened. There was no connection between me and God in that moment. Much like the baptism of the men in Ephesus. They had been baptized in John's baptism. And it's a baptism of repentance. And so there was some level of connection with God, but not the same connection that we have through Jesus Christ. And so they were kind of like I was, halfway believers, willing, but just not maybe getting it fully. Not fully connecting with God. Oddly enough, my sister, who was 2 years older than I am, still is 2 years older than I am, when they asked her, do you believe in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? She said yes in her heart. And came to faith that day, sitting in a boardroom with a bunch of men, asking questions. When Paul challenged the men at Ephesus, they didn't know any better. And when he described John as pointing toward the one who's coming after, and that is Jesus, they believed. And when Paul laid hands on them, they received the Holy Spirit. This is one of the few passages that almost supports our method of baptism, the laying on of water. We do not sprinkle. People always call it sprinkling, and I think in some Catholic churches they actually sprinkle. I've seen it done with a rose. Where they dip the rose in the water, and then they flick the rose at the child. And anyway, we don't sprinkle. We baptize by the laying of our hands on those being baptized. Our palm full of water. Many don't regard that as being properly baptized. And so among Baptists, I'm welcome still because I was baptized by immersion. Even though it didn't connect, even though it didn't really mean anything. I've had a few Baptists over the years who said, well, you need to be rebaptized. Now that you believe, now you have to be rebaptized because it has to be done in the proper order. Anyway, it's when Paul lays his hands on them, possibly baptizing them in that moment, that they receive the Holy Spirit. It's not conclusive. They could have been dunked, and then he could have laid his hand on them. I kind of like to imagine that he just took what water was available. And when he laid his hands on them, they received the Holy Spirit. It is a shame that one of the core practices of the church, something every single church, every single Christian church does, universally we practice baptism. But we allow it to divide us. How much water did you use? There's an old joke along that line that I've probably told here before. But I like old jokes. A fellow steps into the water up to his knees, or asks a Baptist pastor, if I'm baptized up to my knees, am I baptized? No. If I'm baptized up to my shoulders, am I baptized? No. If I'm baptized all the way under the water except the tippy top of my head, am I baptized? And he says, no. And the Methodist says, well, that's good. We baptize the most important part. We can start at the top.
My goodness.
But it's a shame that it divides us by denomination, by practice. One of the hard things in the Methodist Church for me at times is that I am forbidden to rebaptize anyone. So if someone comes to me and says, you know, I was baptized as an infant, but I don't have any memory of it, and I'd like to make a public profession of my faith and be rebaptized, I am forbidden by the rules of our church. It's actually a chargeable offense if I rebaptize anyone, except if I do it in the Jordan River, then we're exempted. You're allowed to. It's the weirdest thing. But anyway, a few years ago, I had a man who was dying, and he wanted to be rebaptized. And his story was very much like I described. He was baptized as an infant, but he really felt the need to be baptized. And by rule, I was forbidden to do it. And I was conflicted by my need as a pastor to see to his spiritual needs. Here he was dying, and he had one request. I want to be baptized again. If he had just not told me that he'd been baptized before, I could have baptized him fine, but once you have that knowledge, then you can't ethically do it. And I was so conflicted. But thankfully, I had a Baptist pastor on staff. The Baptist pastor had no problem rebaptizing. And so in their pool, in their home, we went together and we time. But it's one of those quirky things in the United Methodist Church that I wish we had more latitude in. But we take very seriously this, the verse that says there's one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God above all and in all. And so I personally think our stand against rebaptism is a pushback against Baptists who would rebaptize at the drop of a hat, and we want to be different. And it's like, no, we need to be pastoral, we need to be loving, we need to meet people where they are. Over the years, that dilemma has been significant. And I've pushed the envelope at times, trying to not know that maybe someone was baptized before when they want to be baptized in faith to connect with God. There is no other purpose for baptism than connecting with God, connecting with the Holy Spirit. We baptize infants because it is our tradition, trusting that they have been brought into the family of God, where we will, as a community of faith, seek to raise them in order that when they're old enough, they can make that decision for themselves. I joined the Methodist Church when I was 11 years old. It actually was the Methodist Church at that time. It wasn't until the next year we became United Methodists, which kind of dates me. But when other kids were going through confirmation, I was excluded from confirmation class because I was already a member of the church. As a baptized believer, we transferred from the Baptist Church to the Methodist Church. And so I never had the experience of confirmation class that is designed to help students in the class make that connection with God, the same way these men in Ephesus connected with God. Once they had the information, they wanted to believe. Once they knew there was something more, they wanted that something more. And I was kind of on the outside looking in. I was actually on the inside. But anyway, it was an odd experience, and one that I regret to this day, that I didn't have the opportunity with my peers to go through that process, a process I've led many, many times, conscious of wanting to make that connection, wanting to help make sure that young people were able to take that step in their faith. After the baptism in Ephesus, Paul continued to preach in the synagogues. It's important to realize the main hunting ground for new believers was within the synagogues. And it says that both Jews and Greeks in that region, after 2 years, had heard about Jesus Christ. There were, in their synagogues, many people who were what's called proselytes. They were converts to Judaism. People who had come out of the Roman culture of a god for every occasion, who had come to believe in one God, who is the creator of heaven and earth. And so, those people were in many ways very open to Paul's message that God has sent his son, the same one God, has sent his son to die for our sins. And so many converted, many Jewish people converted, many who were proselytes converted to Christianity. But those folk continued to attend synagogue as a place of connection to God. I don't know how many of you have ever been to a synagogue. Just curious. Okay. It's a fascinating experience to hear so much of our faith proclaimed in the synagogue. It just stops short of the whole Jesus thing. We had one Jewish convert in a previous church who Joy tried to ask them, how do they feel about Jesus? And she said, oh, he's just the Jewish boy who messed everything up. That's how they viewed it, not how she viewed it. She was a believer in Jesus Christ. But you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. It's repeated, the Shema, in every Jewish service. The Great Commandment as we know it. But eventually, as people's hearts became hardened, as lines were drawn, as people became hardened in their opinions, he was forced to leave the church, the synagogue, their place of worship, and strike out on their own. At this point, we weren't really a church. We weren't really known as Christians. They were followers of the way, the truth, and the life. That's how early Christians were known. People of the way are followers of the way. We need to be followers of the way today, to put our faith and hope and trust in Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, as Hebrews says. And in nothing else. These are difficult times in our country. Difficult times in relationships. Difficult times on Facebook. Friendships are questioned and damaged. But if we keep our focus on Christ, the author and finisher of our faith, he will see us through. Someone told me this morning, there's too much me and not enough we. That's a good thought. We who love the Lord need to love one another. That's the other half of the Great Commandment. love the Lord your God with all your strength.
Heart, soul,
mind, and strength. Thank you. If I start the wrong one, it won't come out. And love your neighbor as yourself. They're inexorably entwined. They're like a Chinese finger puzzle. They go together, and you can't pull them apart. We need both loving God and loving our neighbor, and loving ourselves, being open to where God would lead us from this point forward. If we're hardened in our faith that things have to be a certain way, or this side or that side, or whatever, we don't allow the work of the Holy Spirit to continue to speak to us. We can become like those in Ephesus who just didn't get it if we fail to continue to listen to the Lord our God. You are loved by the God of all creation. Every one of us. And there is no size. God loves us all. And I pray for healing in our land, where we can with one voice love our neighbor.
Jesus is mine. Oh.
May that blessed assurance be with us all. And may the love of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless, preserve, and keep us now and forevermore.